In this lecture, we will discuss about the glossopharyngeal nerve, the ninth cranial nerve, and embryologically the nerve of the third pharyngeal arch. The glossopharyngeal nerve derives its name from the two Greek words, the glosso and the pharynx. The glosso means for the tongue and pharynx stands for the throat. So a nerve which innervates the tongue and the throat, it is the glossopharyngeal nerve. Clinically, if we see the lesions of the glossopharyngeal nerve or injuries to the glossopharyngeal nerve, they are not very common. Usually, the nerve is involved along with the vagus and other nerves. But glossopharyngeal nerve, it mediates an important protective reflex, that is the gag reflex or pharyngeal reflex, that help to avoid choking of a person. Moreover, the glossopharyngeal neuralgias can occur due to involvement of the nerve in traumas or the tumors, where the medical and surgical treatments, they may be required. So in this lecture, we will study about the gross anatomy and the applied importance of the glossopharyngeal nerve. First, the some of the special features of the nerve. Glossopharyngeal nerve, it is a mixed type of the nerve having a sensory component, a motor component, and also a parasympathetic component. The sensory component of the nerve, it will receive the sensations from the pharynx, posterior one-third of the tongue, soft palate, carotid sinus, and also from the tympanic cavity and the eustachian tube, while the motor component of the nerve will innervate the stylopharyngeous muscle. Parasympathetic part of the glossopharyngeal nerve, it is secretomotor for the parotid gland. So a mixed type of nerve having a sensory, motor, and parasympathetic component. Moreover, the glossopharyngeal nerve, it is the nerve of the third pharyngeal arch, so it supplies the derivatives of the third pharyngeal arch, which is the stylopharyngeous muscle. So now we will discuss the glossopharyngeal nerve under following headings. First is course, then nuclei and functional components, branches, and applied anatomy. First is the course of the nerve. First, we will briefly outline the course and then we will discuss in detail the relations and the course of the nerve. The glossopharyngeal nerve, it takes origin from the medulla, as we can see in this diagram, origin of the nerve from medulla. After taking origin from the medulla, the nerve will pass through the jugular foramen along with the vagus and the accessory nerve. And after leaving the cranial cavity through the jugular foramen, the nerve will pass in relation to the important blood vessels that are the internal carotid artery and internal jugular vein. Further course of the nerve will be along the pharyngeal muscles and it will be distributed to along the mucosa of the pharynx and also to the tongue and the soft palate. So course of the nerve, it is from the medulla oblongata, leaving the cranial cavity through jugular foramen, then running in relation to the internal jugular vein and internal carotid artery. Then further courses over the pharyngeal muscles and then it will be distributed over the tongue, pharynx and the palate. So now we will discuss in detail the course and the relations of the nerve. First is the origin of the nerve from the medulla oblongata. So in this diagram we can see a ventral view of the brain stem in which we can see the pons, medulla and the cerebellum. And in the medulla, in the central part, we can see two elevations. These are the pyramids due to underlying pyramidal tracts. Lateral to the pyramid, an oval elevation olive is seen, which is due to the inferior olivary nucleus. Between the pyramid and olive, a sulcus, anterolateral sulcus, is present. Now, lateral to the olive, there is inferior cerebellar peduncle, which is separated from the olive by this black line, which is marking the posterolateral sulcus. And along this posterolateral sulcus, three nerves, they will take origin. First is this 9th, 10th, 2nd, 10th, then third is the 11th cranial nerve. So origin of the glossopharyngeal nerve, it is between the olive and the inferior cerebellar peduncle along a posterolateral sulcus and in line with the 10th and 11th cranial nerve. The ninth nerve, it is attached to the medulla by 3 to 4 rootlets. And these rootlets are the axons of the nuclei, which are present in the caudal part of the pons and the medulla. So the nuclei of origin of the glossopharyngeal nerve, they are, as we see in this diagram, the caudal part of the pons and the medulla have been highlighted, and we can see the nuclei of origin of the glossopharyngeal nerve. There are three nuclei of origin. First is this, which we have marked with the yellow color. This is the inferior salivatory nucleus, which is the parasympathetic secretomotor nucleus. So as the name is suggesting, this nucleus will carry the secretomotor fibers for the salivary gland, and the nerve which is innervated by, and the gland which is innervated by this part of the nuclei, it is the parotid gland. So in this diagram, we can see with the yellow fibers from the inferior salivatory nucleus up to the parotid gland along the course of the glossopharyngeal nerve. So first nucleus of origin of the glossopharyngeal nerve, it is inferior salivatory nucleus, which is parasympathetic secretomotor nucleus. The second motor nucleus for the nerve, it is the nucleus ambiguus, which is marked with the red color. This nucleus ambiguus is a common nucleus for the 9th, 10th and 11th nerve. Since this is a motor nucleus, it will carry the fibers for the muscle, that is the stylopharyngeus muscle. So the first nucleus which we have studied, secretomotor, inferior salivatory. Second is the nucleus ambiguus, which is the motor nucleus. The third nucleus of origin of glossopharyngeal nerve, it is the sensory nucleus, and this nucleus is named as the nucleus of tractus solitarius. So this nucleus is a common nucleus for the 7th, 9th and the 10th cranial nerve, and it will receive the taste sensations and the general sensations from the tongue. And the glossopharyngeal nerve, it will carry the taste and the general sensations from the posterior one-third of the tongue, as we can see the with the blue color, the course of the fibers up to the nucleus tractus solitarius. Now this nucleus tractus solitarius, it is not only receiving the fibers from the tongue, but general sensations from the pharynx, tonsil and the soft palate, which have been marked with this green color. They will also travel along this glossopharyngeal nerve up to the nucleus of tractus solitarius. So three nuclei of origin of the glossopharyngeal nerve: inferior salivatory, a secretomotor, nucleus ambiguous, a motor nucleus for muscles, and a nucleus tractus solitarius for the taste and the general sensations from the tongue, pharynx, soft palate and the carotid sinus and the carotid body. So with the next diagram, we can just revise these nuclei. The inferior salivatory nucleus for parotid gland, ambiguous for the stylopharyngeus muscle, and tractus solitarius, which is carrying the taste and general sensations from the tongue, carotid sinus and the pharynx. And fibers from all these nuclei, they will collectively form a glossopharyngeal nerve, which is now a mixed nerve carrying the parasympathetic, motor and the sensory fibers. Now these nuclei, they lie under the functional components. As we see in this diagram, there are total 7 functional columns or functional components. To the left are the efferent groups and to the right are the afferent groups. And the nuclei of the glossopharyngeal nerve, they lie under the columns which have been marked with the yellow color. So the first group, it is for the somatic efferent group, in which only the cranial nerve nuclei which are supplying the muscles of the body wall are present. Second group is special visceral efferent group, in which the cranial nerve nuclei which are innervating the muscles derived from the pharyngeal arch are present. So since the glossopharyngeal nerve, it is the nerve of third pharyngeal arch and it is supplying the stylopharyngeus muscle, a muscle of third arch. So nucleus ambiguous, which is the motor nucleus, it will lie under the category special visceral efferent group. Third column is the general visceral efferent group, in which the nuclei which are preganglionic, parasympathetic and secretomotor nuclei, they lie. And for the glossopharyngeal nerve, it is the inferior salivatory nucleus for the parotid gland. So this will lie under the category of general visceral efferent group. Now the afferent columns, they are the special visceral efferent and general visceral efferent columns. Since glossopharyngeal nerve, it carries the general and taste sensations from the posterior one-third of tongue and valid papilla up to this nucleus of tractus solitarius, दिस न्यूक्लियस इट विल लाई अंडर द स्पेशल एज वेल एज द जनरल विस्ट्रल एफरेंट ग्रुप. सो थ्री न्यूक्लियाई ऑफ द ग्लॉसोफेरेंजियल नर्व लाइंग अंडर द कैटेगरी ऑफ स्पेशल विस्ट्रल एफरेंट, जनरल विस्ट्रल एफरेंट एंड द थर्ड इज फॉर द स्पेशल विस्ट्रल एफरेंट एंड जनरल विस्ट्रल एफरेंट. सो इफ वी राइट देम कलेक्टिवली वी कैन राइट एज first nucleus which we had studied, that was the motor nucleus, nucleus ambiguous, special visceral efferent for the muscles of pharyngeal arch. So this is motor to stylopharyngeus. Second nucleus, general visceral efferent for inferior salivatory nucleus, which will be secretomotor for the parotid gland. Third, which has been lying under the group of special visceral efferents and general visceral efferent, it is the nucleus of tractus solitarius, which is receiving the general as well as taste sensations from the tongue and also from the pharynx and carotid body and the carotid sinus. So that is about the nuclei of origin of the glossopharyngeal nerve, having three nuclei, a sensory, a motor and parasympathetic nucleus. Now the further course from the medulla and the pons. Now, after taking origin from the medulla in the form of 3 to 4 rootlets, the nerve, it will pass through this jugular foramen. And here the nerve, it will bear two ganglia, a superior and an inferior ganglia. The superior ganglia, it is lying in the jugular foramen itself, while the inferior ganglia will be lying below the jugular foramen. There are no branches of the nerve from the superior ganglia, and all the branches, they are from this inferior ganglia, and superior ganglia is thought to be just a detached part from the inferior ganglia. In the jugular foramen, the nerve, it is also related to the other cranial nerves, which we can see with the next diagram, which show a detailed view of the jugular foramen. So here we can see the complete picture of the jugular foramen, in which medial post part of the jugular foramen there will be inferior petrosal sinus, and in the middle part of the jugular foramen three cranial nerves, they are leaving the skull, that are the 9th, 10th and 11th. And the 9th cranial nerve, it will lie in a separate sheath of dura mater separate from the 10th and 11th nerve. In the lateral most part of the jugular foramen, internal jugular vein is present, which is a continuation from the sigmoid sinus. So nerve, it will leave the cranial cavity through the jugular foramen, and now it will pass in relation to the important blood vessels, that are the internal carotid artery and the internal jugular vein. So after reaching up anterior to the internal carotid artery, now the next course of the nerve will be deep to this, it will lie deep to this styloid process and along the posterior border of this muscle, that is the stylopharyngeus muscle. And further course of the nerve after the styloid process will be along the muscles of the pharynx, which we will see with the next diagram. So we have studied the course of the nerve from the medulla and through the jugular foramen, then in relation with the important blood vessels, and now the muscle, now the nerve, it will lie in relation to the pharyngeal muscles. So in this diagram, we can again see the styloid process and the stylopharyngeous muscle. So the nerve will lie deep to the styloid process along the posterior border of the stylopharyngeous muscle, and then over the superior constrictor and middle constrictor muscle of the pharynx, the nerve will further pass along these muscles up to the tongue, and also it will reach up to the soft palate, and where it will give its final branches, the lingual and the tonsillar branches. So this is the complete course of the nerve. Here we can see origin from the medulla by three nuclei, then through the jugular foramen, and then in relation to the blood, major blood vessels, and finally it is lying in relation to the pharyngeal muscles, tongue and the soft palate. Now we will study the branches of the glossopharyngeal nerve. The first branch from the glossopharyngeal nerve, from the inferior ganglia, it is the tympanic branch. This tympanic branch will leave along the inferior ganglia and it will reach up to this tympanic cavity, where in the tympanic cavity, it will form a plexus, that is the tympanic plexus. And Here it will supply the tympanic cavity and mastoid air cells and mastoid antrum. And the fibers now, they will leave the tympanic cavity as the lesser petrosal nerve. And we can see the detailed course in the next diagram. Here we can see the detailed course of the tympanic nerve. So inferior ganglia, from this the tympanic nerve, which is forming a tympanic plexus in the tympanic cavity and leaving the tympanic cavity as the lesser petrosal nerve. And the lesser petrosal nerve will leave the skull through this foramen ovale and along with the mandibular nerve, and it will relay in the otic ganglion. And now the postganglionic fibers from the otic ganglion, they will pass along the auriculotemporal branch of the mandibular nerve, and fibers, they will reach up to the parotid gland. So before the otic ganglion, these are the preganglionic fibers, and the fibers which are passing along the auriculotemporal nerve, they are the postganglionic fibers. So the first branch of glossopharyngeal nerve, as we see in this, the yellow mark, it is carrying the secretomotor fibers from the inferior salivatory nucleus and carrying it to the tympanic cavity, then through the lesser petrosal nerve and postganglionic branches from otic ganglion up to the parotid gland. So this is the first branch from the glossopharyngeal nerve. The second branches from the glossopharyngeal nerve, they are along the carotid body and the carotid sinus, which are present at the level of division of the common carotid into external and internal carotid. So here the glossopharyngeal nerve, it will supply the baroreceptors and the chemoreceptor present in the carotid sinus and the carotid body, and it will form a plexus along with the vagus and sympathetic nerves here. So all these sensations, they from these sinus and the carotid body, they will be carried up to this nucleus rectus solitarius. So second branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve which we have studied are the carotid branch. Now next branches from the nerve, they are the muscular branches which will supply the stylopharyngeus muscle, and these are the motor fibers from the glossopharyngeal nerve originating from the nucleus ambiguus. The next branches, as the nerve lie in relation to the pharyngeal muscles, it will form a pharyngeal plexus along with the vagus and the sympathetic nerve, and the glossopharyngeal nerve will be only sensory to the mucosa of the pharynx. Further branches from the glossopharyngeal nerve, they are to the tonsillar branches which will pass to the soft palate and to the tonsil. And the last branches, they are the lingual branches which will pass to the velate papilla and posterior one-third of the tongue. And from the tongue, both type of fibers, the general and the special fibers of taste, they will be carried along the glossopharyngeal nerve up to the nucleus of the rectus solitarius. So these are the branches from the glossopharyngeal nerve. Just revising these branches, the first branch, tympanic branch, which was secretomotor for the parotid gland. The second branch, this was carotid branch for the carotid sinus and carotid body. The third, it is the muscular branch for the stylopharyngeus muscle. Then branches for the pharyngeal mucosa along the pharyngeal plexus. Then we have tonsillar branches for the soft palate and the tonsil. And lastly, the lingual branches. All these branches we can revise with the help of this simplified diagram. The tympanic branch, carotid branch, branch to stylopharyngeus, tonsillar branch, pharyngeal, and the lingual branches of the glossopharyngeal nerve. So that is about the course, relations, and the branches of the glossopharyngeal nerve, which we have studied from the medulla through the jugular foramen, then in relation to important blood vessels, and finally in relation to the pharyngeal muscles. Now we will discuss about the applied anatomy of the nerve. The glossopharyngeal nerve, it is involved in a very important reflex, that is the pharyngeal reflex or the gag reflex, which is a protective type of reflex, where there will be a reflex contraction of the pharyngeal muscles when we touch the roof of the mouth or area around the tonsils or the back of the throat. As we see with the next diagram, And if we touch this roof of the mouth or the back of the throat, there will be a reflex contraction of the pharyngeal muscles, and this reflex contraction will prevent the swallowing of unwanted substance, and it will help to avoid choking of a person. Now, since the glossopharyngeal nerve, it is supplying the mucosa of the pharynx, it will form the afferent route for the pharyngeal reflex, while the efferent route will be by the vagus nerve, which is supplying these pharyngeal muscles. So if we have to test the glossopharyngeal nerve, we can do so by testing the pharyngeal reflex when we touch the back of the mouth or the roof of the mouth or towards the back of the mucosa of the pharynx. There will be a reflex contraction of the pharyngeal muscles. But if the lesions occur in the glossopharyngeal nerve, any injury, any trauma to the nerve, it can result in the loss of the gag reflex or the pharyngeal reflex. Along with this, there will be a difficulty in swallowing. There will be loss of sensations from the posterior one-third of the tongue and velate papilla. There will be loss of general sensations as well as the taste sensation. And since the nerve, it is also carrying secretomotor fibers to the parotid gland, there will be a dysfunction of the parotid gland also. The glossopharyngeal nerve, usually it is not involved in isolated lesions. Usually it is involved along with the vagus or the accessory nerve. But clinical condition which may affect the ninth nerve in particular, they can be either styloid fracture, as the nerve, it is lying in relation to the styloid process. The fractures can involve the nerve, or there can be a long styloid process known as the Eagle syndrome, or there can be pain along the nerve, glossopharyngeal neuralgia. Iatrogenic injuries can occur to the nerve while placing a laryngeal mask airway. And also in carcinomas of the tonsil, the nerve can be involved. The Eagle syndrome, we can see with the next diagram. Here we can see a normal styloid process and an enlarged styloid process. This enlarged styloid process is because of ossification of the stylohyoid ligament, which is attached to the tip of the styloid process. And if there is this long styloid process, it may result in compression of the glossopharyngeal nerve, and patient will complain of the throat pain, neck pain, or tinnitus, or he may have increased pain with the head movement. So this condition is known as the Eagle syndrome, when the styloid process is unusually long due to ossification of the ligament stylohyoid. Moreover, glossopharyngeal nerve can be involved in the neuralgias, where there is a pain by the mandibular actions such as swallowing, chewing, coughing, or yawning. And this neuralgia can occur from the trauma, neoplasms, or any infections, surgery, or malformations which may involve the glossopharyngeal nerve. And patient will complain of the pain on the tonsils, posterior throat, or along the base of the tongue. And treatment for these glossopharyngeal neuralgias are with the help of anti-epileptic and antidepressant drugs. The glossopharyngeal nerve can also be involved in conditions like the endarterectomy, which is a procedure in which we remove a plaque from the carotid vessels. And while removing this plaque, sometimes there may occur injuries to the vagus nerve or the glossopharyngeal nerve. And the damage to this glossopharyngeal nerve can cause the unilateral decrease in the saliva production. So this is about the applied anatomy of the glossopharyngeal nerve, which is involved in a protective gag reflex and sometimes may be involved in the neuralgias, Eagle syndromes, or during the endarterectomy, there may be damage to the nerve. So that completes the topic on the glossopharyngeal nerve, its gross anatomy and the applied anatomy. Just a revision of what we have studied. There are three nuclei of origin for the glossopharyngeal nerve: inferior salivatory, a secretomotor, parasympathetic nucleus, nucleus ambiguus, a motor nucleus, and nucleus of tractus solitarius for the general and taste sensations from the posterior one-third of the tongue, from the pharynx, middle ear cavity, soft palate, and the tonsils. The glossopharyngeal nerve, after its origin from the medulla, it will pass through the jugular foramen, having two ganglia, superior and inferior ganglia. And branches of the nerve, they are the tympanic branches for the tympanic branches, which will continue as lesser petrosal nerve and carry secretomotor fibers to the parotid gland. Then we have the branches for the stylopharyngeus muscle, branches to the carotid sinus and to the soft palate, tonsil and to posterior one-third of the tongue. Both taste and general sensations will be carried by the nerves. So that completes the topic of the glossopharyngeal nerve, its gross and the applied anatomy. Thank you.